I am number one in the next car. Now I'm separated from my family. I get up on the car. All I see is two steel drums in the center. One is full of water. One is empty, which turns out to be for human waste. Little straw on the ground. And as soon as another 79 human beings, which could be anything from babies to children to pregnant women to grandparents, come into my car, the door is closed. This is taking several hours. It's stifling in there. It's the spring of 1944. But we are packed in there like sardines. And we don't know what's going to happen to us. Finally, the train starts going. I eat my apple because I'm hungry. And a little while later, I eat my piece of bread. After the first day, all the water is gone. The stench is horrific. Babies are crying. People are praying. Screaming and yelling is just terrible, scary. After 3 days and three nights, the train stops, doors open, SS guards with German shepherds are screaming and yelling, alle heraus, which in German means everybody out, and young men are coming towards the cattle cars. They are prisoners, they are wearing blue and white striped uniforms, and their job is to empty the trains because people die on the way, clean up the cars, because the trains will be going back to Hungary to get another 430,000 Jews from Hungary to bring to this one place. We don't know where we are. All you see, wherever you look, is barbed wire. It's a huge, huge, huge barracks. And everything is so meticulously planned. The orders come one after another. I meet up with my family, hardly have time to give a hug to my mother and two sisters, because the order comes women and girls this side, and children, and this side men, boys from about mid-teens, old men, everybody. Rows of five, we start going to the front. There's a line of SS officers. Some of them have white coats, they are doctors. And then the five of us get to the front row. There is an SS officer, beautifully dressed uniform, shiny boots, has a riding crop in his hand, and just like this to my father, you this way, points to me, you this way, and a couple other, but three other people in our row, the same leader to the right, to the left. My father is walking away from me. I figured, well, you know, we're going to meet up later. We don't. I never see my father again. I don't know where we are, what's happening. All I know is that I'm famished, I'm dying of thirst, and I'm totally stressed out. I find myself in an open field next to the barracks. Order comes, take off all your clothing and your shoes. I didn't realize at that moment. But this little pile of clothing in front of me and my shoes was the last connection to being a human being. Because from this point on, the SS can do anything they want with me. I don't know this, but this is a fact. And then the order comes. Always double time, single file. You run to the first station. Prisoners are cut off all your air, your head, your body. Then you run between two rows of prisoners who are pumping white powder, chemicals all over your body. Then you run into a big, big barracks. All you see is shower heads. No towels, no soap. And all of a sudden, cold water comes out. And all of us just arrived from home are dying of thirst. So everybody's just standing there with their mouth open, drinking in the water, drinking in the water, drinking in the water. Prisoners are drinking out of tables and they put slices of bread that's already in pieces. You hold out your soup dish, they lay some watery soup in there. It smells terrible and it tastes terrible, but you gobble it down because you are starving. And then you get a piece of bread, and it looks like bread, but it tastes like sawdust. Again, you eat it. And I'm waiting and waiting and waiting for my father to show up. He doesn't. And I don't know why. And now we have the prisoners from other countries in Europe. And I find a Polish prisoner who has been in this situation for 2-3 years, at least more than I was. I'm a newcomer. And I asked him, because he spoke fluent German, how come my father was sent to the left and I was sent to the right? He says to me, come with me. He takes me outside the barracks and he points in the distance and you see this tall brick chimney spewing smoke and flames and sparks. And just like he was talking about the weather, he's telling me, your father is going up the chimney. My brain can't break this down. What is he talking about? I was with my father, you know, a few hours before. How can this happen? And then he tells me where I am. He tells me why I am here. He tells me what's going on. And he tells me the following. This is Auschwitz-Birkenau. This is the biggest killing machine on the face of the earth. Eventually 1.1 million people, not just Jews, but anybody that the Third Reich didn't think was worthwhile to stay alive, were killed here. There are gas chambers here. There are crematoriums here. They got to the point in the early 40s when the Nazis were killing all the so-called undesirable all over Europe, that they have to come up with some ideas to do the killing faster, more efficiently, so they can kill more people in a smaller time frame. So this was it. A trainload of Hungarian Jews, like us, arrived. The selection took place, which meant that 80% of the people who arrived, which includes children, old people, sick people, will be killed in the gas chambers immediately. And that 20% will be sent to slave labor camps all over Europe to be killed through slave labor. I don't know this. He's telling me this. I don't know what slave labor is. I don't know what a crematorium is. I don't know what a gas chamber is. But I understand that I am in a terrible, terrible place. And what happens the next morning when you're woken up to stand in detention for hours to be counted? The first thing you see when you come out, there are bodies hanging on the electrified fence. These are prisoners who arrived with me from home, threw themselves on the electrified fences to kill themselves. I couldn't understand how can you give up so fast, but then I realized something. They must have been talking to somebody, just like I did, speaking to this Polish prisoner who told me what's happening here, and they realized that their families are gone. Their children are dead. So why should they live, and throw themselves on electrified fence? I am in Auschwitz about 3 weeks. Then I am taken out one of the selections. I am marched out to the same railroad platform where I arrived with my family. I know my father is dead. I have absolutely no idea what happened to my mother and two sisters. I am being sent to a slave labor camp. They don't tell me, but I find out to see what happened. So they have hundreds of prisoners to get on the train. The train, fortunately, only goes about 12, 14 hours. It stops, doors open, SS guards. Everybody line up in single file, they're gonna feed you. They give you some soup that has a couple of pieces of veggies in it, a little bigger piece of bread that you got in Auschwitz, a little pad of margarine to put on your bread, and you think you're in seventh heaven. This is so much better. It isn't. This is Wolfsburg. This is a rectangular camp, machine gun towers in the corners, one gate, four large buildings. One is for the SS administration, One is a kitchen where our food is made. One is a washroom slash latrine. And one is an infirmary. This is where you go if you're sick. But you have to be really, really sick. You just can't walk in that you have a toothache or you have a headache. All the rest of the prisoners, about 5,000 of us, are in circular tents. We start off at about 25 prisoners to a tent, so we're like really close, and then they put an extra 5 prisoners to reach the level of slave laborers in this camp. And you're really like sardines, you head towards the wall, you feet towards the potbelly stove. And let me give you an example of what a slave labor camp. In this case, Wolfsburg, because I did some research after the war, was one of about a dozen slave labor camps in this vicinity. They had one master plan. Every camp did one portion of this master plan. Some of the camps were building roads, trucks can run on. Some of them were building railroads. Some of them were blasting tunnels in the mountains in the vicinity. The whole idea was that when Allied bombers are coming and you are in a Nazi convoy, either in trucks or trains, you could hide in the mountains so you won't get hurt, won't get killed, and the equipment you're carrying won't get lost. In the morning, we have columns. Everyone in that camp is going to go out to a work site. Column A, B, C, D, and so on. Rows of 5. I am in column A. They need 200 prisoners at work site A. We march out of the camp, 2 SS guards and 2 capos attach themselves. The capos are usually German criminals, because Hitler emptied all the jails in Germany, sent them all to concentration camps, and due to the fact that they were German and they were fluent in their language, they become go-between the prisoners and the SS guards, which meant that in a lot of cases they were a lot more cruel than the guards, because they got an extra piece of bread or an extra ladle of soup. They wanted to keep their jobs, so they did most of the beatings and kicking and everything else if you didn't move fast enough. So I am going out with these 200 prisoners to the same station and arrived the day before. And there's a large pyramid of steel rails that the trains run on. And they assign 3 prisoners to each one of the rails. One in the front, one in the middle, one in the back. Put it on your shoulder. You start marching about a football field length. Put it down. Other prisoners are picking it up and carrying it further. Then you go back to the pyramid, start all over. The rails are extremely heavy. You keep switching from one shoulder to the other, then back to the original side, and this goes on from sunup to sundown. Both of your shoulders are bleeding. My 16-year-old brain is telling me, if you're going to do this day in and day out, you're going to last a few weeks and that will be the end of it. What am I going to do? I got to do something. Then all of a sudden I realized all 5,000 of us in this camp look exactly alike. We have the same kind of uniforms. There's no assignment to any of their columns to be in. Tomorrow morning, instead of going to column A, because the Germans were very meticulous about where they're going to send people, so column A would always be going to the station with the steel rails. I'm going to column G. It's going to be slave labor. I'm going to be cutting down trees. I'm going to start working on roads, digging ditches, everything else. It's slave labor. Eventually, it's going to kill you. But not as fast as this other thing was doing with the rails. And then a couple of weeks go by, and the first thing that you see when you come out of your tent is a dead prisoner at the tent right next to you. and you look at this dead person and a human being, and the first thing that comes in your brain is, he's somebody's father, somebody's son, somebody's cousin, somebody's brother. They are never going to make it home. And then as time goes by, as more people die, more people are dying of hunger, more people are dying of diseases, accidents on the work side. But don't worry, we have 5,000 prisoners, now several hundred of them have died. New prisoners are shipped in. The level of the slave labor stays perfectly the same. So they can't miss any kind of work. Now I am about 6 months into my imprisonment, and I'm coming home in the dark on a Friday, and I'm totally exhausted, and I realize something. I have got to come up with something in my brain to keep me going. This work is killing me. There's not enough food to keep me alive. What can I come up with to keep me going? I come up with two things. I'm telling myself, number one, my father has been murdered, but I have absolutely no idea where my mother and two sisters are. Are they alive? Are they dead? I don't know. But I'm telling myself they're alive, and they're gonna come home and this horror is over, this war is over. And how terrible would it be if my mother and two sisters get old, and no father and no only son remains. I gotta stay alive just as much for myself as for my mother and two sisters. And the other thing I come up with is, if the SS kills me, they win. If I stay alive, I win. I am telling myself these two things every night before I fall asleep exhausted. And every morning, the first thing I think about when I wake up is the same two things. From that point on, this is an everyday event. Things don't look good. Winter is coming. You're in pajamas. Finally, trucks come and they dump winter jackets, winter coats, real shoes instead of wooden shoes. These are obviously have been in some warehouse somewhere. The owners of these coats and shoes are long dead, but now they are being taken to the slave labor camps to keep the prisoners working through the winter. And every civilian piece of clothing, like your jacket or your coat, is covering your striped uniform. So everyone on the back of the garment is a big red bullseye. So in case you start running away from the camp to try to escape, the SS knows exactly where to aim to kill you. And one morning, as we are standing in attention to be counted, the young prisoners are always in the front of the columns all over, an SS sergeant stops right there, about 6 feet from me, and he looks around at the young prisoners and says, which one of the young prisoners speaks fluent German? Here, in my brain, is the first computer on the face of the earth. I'm telling myself, okay, if they want to kill 200 prisoners today, they can do it. Why should they pick on one person? Put my hand up. He says, come with me. I go with him. Takes me out of the camp gate. There's a man in civilian clothing. He dismisses the sergeant. I'm standing in attention, take my hat off, telling him my prisoner number, and he tells me I am Mr. So-and-so in German. He introduces himself like I was a human being. And then he says to me, I'm a civilian engineer. I am assigned to this camp for the next 2 weeks to finalize finishing the roads and railroads and everything else that the camp is building. And I need somebody to help me with my equipment. He gives me this wooden board that has numbers all over it. He has a tripod with some equipment on it and a notebook. And the two of us walk away from the camp. This is the first time in about 8 months that I haven't been with hundreds or thousands of people day in and day out, 24/7. Just the fact that you can hear the birds sing is so wonderful. You don't hear the crying, the praying, the screaming, the yelling that happens around you all the time. He says to me, stand over here, face me with the board with the numbers. I do. He walks away from me. I'm now by myself. He's down, way down there, turns around, puts down his tripod, makes some notes. Come on, I catch up with him. So we do this. It's the first day I was working with him. He has to bring me back because I have to march with my work party back to the camp to be counted. Next morning, the first thing he says to me is this. I see what terrible situation you people are in, you prisoners are in. And I'm sort of suspicious. Is he a wise guy? Is he trying to rub my situation in, you know, that I'm a worthless person and it's okay to be treated this way? But the next thing out of his mouth is this. I am going to bring you back to hook up with your work party to march back to the camp a half hour early. This is going to take us through the woods. When I point to my left, there's the barracks. This is the mess hall for the SS guards and the civilian engineers. No way past lunchtime, don't worry. He's going to stay outside. He says to me, go inside, you see where the kitchen is. Next to the kitchen, there are tables set up for the people to eat. Go to the very first table next to the kitchen. Look under the bench. I go. I look. There's a piece of white paper napkin, piece of chicken, piece of real bread I haven't seen for months, piece of cheese, little paper cup of milk. I drink the milk because I can't carry it. I put the rest in my pocket because I always want to getting this kind of fortunate to get this kind of food, I want to share it with. I always made friends with other prisoners about my age, especially one Polish kid. And I wanted to share this with him. And I come out and I thank him, and I thank him, and I thank him. This man, a German, a Christian, did this for me for 2 weeks. This man saved my life. He was a real human being who saw another human being in dire need. He took a huge chance because the SS guards would have seen him giving me food. He could have wound up in the same camp as a prisoner. Yet he took his chance. This goes on for 2 weeks. Not only that I was able to rebuild my physical self to a point that I could carry on, because I started wondering what day is my last day, but mentally, to know that this German, this Christian, who's supposed to be my enemy, helped me, was so fantastically important right here at that time in the camp and ever since then in my whole life. Saved my life. My 2 weeks are up. I'm going back to slave labor. Everything is practically finished, what we were working on. But the engineers found out that the road that was finished had draining ditches on both sides in case the snow, if there's snow, will melt. It won't be enough to carry the water that melts. So we have to dig the ditches deeper and wider. So about 200 of us are standing in a straight line in the ditch, in pairs. First prisoner, pickaxe. Second prisoner, shovel. I am Mr. Pickaxe. I'm hitting the side of the ditch, and the earth is very hard because it's winter time. And all of a sudden, when I hit the side, a big chunk of dirt comes out, and right behind that, a piece of rusty barbed wire that goes boing, hits me right here on my thigh. big deal, you know, with all the horror that I have seen around me and all the death for months now. This is nothing. And it starts breathing, nothing. We finally go back to the camp. I go to the wash room. I wash it off. I don't have any soap. I don't have any towel. I wash it off and that's it. And next morning I'm ready to go to work. And I go to work and I come back. And a couple days later I notice my thigh is a half a tennis ball. It's swelling up. I realize this is not good news. I go to the infirmary. The infirmary is run by two Greek doctors who are prisoners, who are also Jews from Greece. They are doctors in civilian life, now they run the infirmary. They have orderlies and they have patients. The only time the SS will let you go to this place unless you are dying or you are so injured that you are not going to make it. The bottom line is 90% of the people who go into the infirmary will never come out. 10% will come out and be sent back to slavery. One of them looks at my leg and says, this looks terrible. Have to drain it in the, you know, primitive medical instruments. They cut it, drain it, they sprinkle some medication on it, and they put some paper bandages on my leg. And knowing the reputation of this infirmary, I say, thank you so much, and I'm going out. I'm leaving. He stops me. He said, where are you going? I said, I thought we were finished. He said, no, we have to keep you here for several days. We have to make sure that the infection doesn't go down your leg, because if it does, you won't be able to walk. And if you can't walk, that's the end of you. You can't work. I'm waiting there, and the place is, it's really like being in hell, because people are dying all around, screaming and yelling and everything else. A prisoner comes in and he answers, all work has stopped in Wolfsburg. This camp is going to be evacuated. On such and such a day, which you don't have any newspapers or calendars, you don't know, he tells you the date, we're going to have to leave. Those who are able to march will march to the next destination. Those who are too weak or too sick will be taken by trucks. I am in a lot of pain. I don't know what's going on in my leg. So far, everything is good because they look at my leg on the daily basis, no line of infection. I am going with the marchers. Why am I going with the marchers? Simple reason. I have been with prisoners from all over Europe who have been in those camps a lot longer than I was. They say never, never, never get on any Nazi transportation, because that means that you cannot walk. And if you cannot walk, you're useless. You can't work. So sure enough, we start marching, and the trucks are going right behind us. And apparently there were other prisoners who felt exactly like me. They wanted to march because they don't want to get on the trucks to be killed. And they fall down. And some of the prisoners pick them up and try to help them march, but they're too weak. So they have to drop them. So the SS just push these prisoners into the ditches alongside the road, one shot into your skull, and that's the end of your life. You come to a fork in the road, marchers go this way, trucks go this way. Where are the trucks going? Guess. One guess, the nearest extermination camp where all these useless prisoners will be killed. Why should they feed them? They're not working. We arrive to a huge, huge camp. It's just, all you see, it says, doesn't have electrified fences, but has a lot of machine gun towers all along the barbed wire fences. Huge buildings, just like in Auschwitz. No work here. All is dying. They apparently collected all the survivors from the slave labor camps in the vicinity, and they put them in here
let them die here. Your rations are so minimal that it's not going to keep you alive very long. I made friends with two Polish kids, and it's hardly time for us to sleep because being in the barracks is so horrendous, because it's not unusual that you lay down next to a prisoner who's alive, and when you wake up, they are dead. And also, the noise, the screaming, the praying again, nonstop. So we just go out of the barracks and just walk around. You never want to go through the barbed wire fence where the machine gun towers are. You don't want to wander into that area that is just grass between the barracks and the barbed wire, because if they see you hanging around that place you're not supposed to be there, they'll shoot you. So you make sure you never get into that place. And life goes on. And the guards are taking some prisoners in each barracks that have a little bit of strength left, and they give them an extra piece of bread and an extra ladle of soup. And their job is every morning to collect all the dead prisoners who died during the night, take them outside the barracks, strip them of their uniform. But every prisoner has a prisoner number on his uniform. Before you take it off, you have like a magic marker, and you open their jackets, and on their bare skin, their skeletal body, they put the number. The SS is very meticulous about record keeping. How many millions of people have they killed? Then, when that's done, other prisoners with push carts are coming, putting their dead bodies on, taking them out of the tomb, mass graves. There's a layer of bodies, layer of lime, layer of bodies until it's filled up, and the prisoners cover it with the dirt, and they start the other mass grave. It's scary. How long will you last under these conditions? A little while later, what we noticed is that at night when you go out and you look at the horizon, it's all orange and red. Obviously something is on fire. And also that you start hearing cannon fire, which practically every day comes a little bit closer. You see bombers flying over you. I don't know where they are, so I don't know what direction they are going and why. And one morning we come out of our barracks and look up at the machine gun tower, and the SS guards are not there. And you have to understand your life in these camps. It doesn't matter if you're in a slave labor camp or at the extermination camp, whatever it is, your daily life is exactly the same every day. If anything happens that out of the ordinary, you immediately